things here.
But also, because also there's the thing which is interesting. One of the things that I thought about very early on when I was working on this was the Tempest. And in the first scene of the Tempest, Prospero tells Miranda her story, and in the second scene, she defies him. So that dinner scene between Lawrence and Deborah, she wouldn't have reacted the way she reacted earlier in the film. She is now learning who she is. She knows more. So therefore, it sets up a power dynamic. So it's really about who has the power here. It's about the passion of wanting to know. And also, Lawrence was old enough to remember, so he remembers the pain. He remembers his mother's being burned from inside from the treatment that she was receiving because of the cancer. Deborah doesn't have any memory, so anything that she learns, she's collecting Jurassic Park because there's something in there about cloning. She's just grabbing onto stories. She's trying to know the truth. She's trying to run from.
And even in that scene when he says, you don't remember how thin she got, you don't remember how they put things up in her and burned her, she's learning that and hearing that for the first time. So that's part of the reason she's motivated to get up and leave, because, okay, now you're going to tell me, I've been asking you for years to talk about her, and this is how you're going to do it while you're attacking me? So I felt that she was losing power in that moment. And so because she was losing power in that moment, she had to exit.
But she also sort of rears up in that scene, too. I mean, it really is the Tempest, that way you're talking about it, just sort of stick in territory. And interestingly, there was kind of a collective of things.
Yeah.
I mean, I love that. And I just want you guys to talk about it a little bit, that she surrounds herself with stuff.
Yeah. That was a tiny little room. And when we went to Baltimore last summer to meet with the family for the first time, I did this thing. I stopped by her old house. I got her address where she used to live. And I just knocked on the door on a sunny morning. Standing outside just in case something went down. So he's standing outside, go on. And I knocked on the door and I said, that guy opens the door, so there's that moment. Tiny. So not enough room to change your mind in that room. And then we had the whole camera crew and all that. So she was paranoid and but also felt comforted. It was like a wound. So she was afraid of animals, but yet trying not to be afraid. So in her actual room, there were all these pictures of dogs and cats and
horses.
And horses. It looks like a kid's room, and you know, things that she'd made with her grandson signs and things like that. So it's a time very claustrophobic, and shooting at 100 degrees in Georgia in August.
Every day. But also, the other thing is really interesting. I mean, every damn day. And you know, your skull was like the microwave oven, and then the rays would come down and cook your brain. It just happened every day. It can suffocate the spirit, so that finally, so you go from the claustrophobia of that to expand. So when you go to clover, when you get out of that, then all of a sudden there is some relief. And because the spirit can live in that place, can live in clover, the brain can breathe, the spirit can breathe in that place with so many images coming at you and so much noise. I want to try to think as much noise as I possibly could in Baltimore, so that when we got out, the sound of a board creaking takes on another kind of color.
There's also a lot of literal sounds, people aren't talking so much, but I just want to get back to that.